Hey, so this is a four-track loop station based on Raspberry Pi. I can record a loop like this. Okay, so that's looping now, and I can overdub on top of that. I can record on a different track. I could overdub on top of that again. I could record on the two remaining tracks, all that kind of stuff. You know, the basic stuff that a loop station does. Now, I have tried and kept this build simple, and so that's what this video is going to be. It's going to be a build video. I'm going to show the process, and if you like it, you can make one for yourself, right? And then there's going to be a different demo video, which will probably be linked in this video somewhere, in which I'll go into more detail about the actual operation and how to use it. Okay, so let's get into the build process. The first thing we're going to look at is the materials, the stuff we need. You're going to need a Raspberry Pi, of course. I'm using a Pi 4B Plus, and I did try it on a Pi 0W, but that didn't work particularly well. You're going to also want a USB sound card. This one is a really cheap one, but you can use a better one for, you know, better sound quality. I'm going to also need some LEDs. I'm using green LEDs to indicate when a track is playing and red LEDs to indicate when a track is recording. You're also going to want some buttons to control the whole thing. These are momentary push to connect buttons. And also you're going to need some current limiting resistors for the LEDs. These are 100 ohm resistors, and you could use larger values, but I wouldn't recommend using much smaller values. You're also going to need some jumper wires to connect things to the Raspberry Pi GPIO, and just some regular wire to solder other stuff together, such as the audio jacks and that kind of thing. And finally, you're going to want something to act as an enclosure. Essentially, I'm using this electrical junction box. So the first step is to make a bunch of holes in the top of the junction box for the LEDs and the buttons to fit through. Here I'm just putting all the buttons into place. They do have four terminals each, but I'm not that worried about the orientation because they work as long as you connect to two diagonally opposite terminals. So now I'll just put a piece of tape on all of them to hold them in place so that I can turn them over and start soldering stuff. Now one end of each button needs to go to ground. That's going to be through this black wire that jumps to one terminal of each button. And the other terminal of each button needs to go to the GPIO, so I'm soldering jumper wires to those. The next step is to connect 100 ohm current limiting resistors to the positive terminal of each LED. When that's done, they can be fitted into the holes made for them. Now, the negative terminals of all the LEDs need to go to ground as well, so I just connected them all together using a black wire, connected that to the black wire I'd previously soldered, and then attached a jumper wire to that, which can go into the ground pin on the Raspberry Pi GPIO. Now the LEDs need jumper wires as well in order to be able to connect to the GPIO, and so that's what I'm doing here. I'm putting on jumper wires, but I'm putting them on the current limiting resistors because those need to be in series with the LEDs. A bit of hot glue at the base of each LED and each button will hold the wires in place and make sure they don't get pulled off as easily, at least. So the next step is preparing the enclosure by essentially cutting a bunch of holes in it so that the Raspberry Pi sits flush against the wall and I can access the USB-C connector to power it. Now, as you can see, I kind of messed up and I didn't leave enough space for the USB connector for the sound card. That's obviously not something you want to do. I had to cut a hole in the side. Now let's talk about audio. The looper has two outputs. The first one is connected directly to the input, which means that whatever you're doing live is going to be heard through this output. The input also, of course, goes to the Raspberry Pi. And then the output from the Raspberry Pi goes to a second output on the looper, which means that your actual loops that are going to be playing on the Pi are going to be heard on this second output. The reason I didn't add extra circuitry to combine the two signals into a single output is because that would have made the project significantly more complicated, and I wanted to keep it simple. As it is, you can plug these two outputs into a mixer or an amp or portable PA system that has two inputs, or even an audio interface that has two inputs with independent gain settings. So chances are you probably have something that you can plug this into. Now, for myself, I actually did build a little mixer that works with this. I'll link to a schematic for this in the description. If you want to, you could even incorporate the circuit directly into your looper. Now, of all the audio connections, the loop's output is probably the simplest. As you can see, it's just a simple headphone-type jack connected to a quarter-inch output. The input could be simple too. You could just connect your input jack to your sound card and also to the live output. In my case, I wanted to be able to plug in a microphone and a guitar simultaneously, so I did this. This is what my input and live output looks like. This plugs into the microphone port on the sound card, and the loop's output, which is this one. Plugs into the headphone port. The last step, as far as the hardware is concerned, is to plug all the jumper wires for the LEDs and the buttons into the right pins on the GPIO. I'll put a link in the description to a text file with a table that tells you, you know, where to connect what. Alright, so now we're going to get into the software part of this, and there's a couple of things you need to do before you can do what I'm about to show you. So, you need to install the Raspbian, or it's now called the Raspberry Pi OS, on an SD card, and you need to boot into that on your Raspberry Pi. Then you need to connect to the internet, and you need to open a Linux terminal. So you can do that either through SSH, like I'm doing right now, or you can just plug a keyboard and a monitor into your Raspberry Pi and do it that way. Once you have a Linux terminal open on your Raspberry Pi and you're connected to the internet, here's what you want to do. So the first thing is to install pulseaudio, which is a Python library that my Python script uses. So I'm going to, there's a couple of ways to do this. So the way that I found seems to work best is to use apt-get. So I'm going to say sudo apt-get install python3-pulseaudio, like that. Press enter. Now I already have pulseaudio installed, so that's just what it's telling me here. Hey, it's already installed. Now if this doesn't work, there's another way, another thing you can try, which is to use pip. So I can say sudo pip3 install pulseaudio, like that. And this should also have the same result for me, since pulseaudio is already installed. It should just tell me, hey, you know, it's already installed, and that's what it has done. Okay, so now the next thing to do is to check the mixer levels, the sound mixer levels. I'm going to type in Alza mixer and press enter, and it's going to open up this mixer that you see. So now if I press F6, I can look at the different audio devices. I can use the arrow keys to scroll down to USB audio device, and I see here that the levels are fine. Now, for you, there's a good chance that if it's the first time you're doing it, the levels are going to be way down here or something. So you can navigate left or right with the left or right arrow keys, and you can use the up and down arrow keys to change the levels. And you want to make sure that your levels look sort of like this, you know, not all the way down like that, so, right? So like this. I'm going to leave them there. I'm going to press escape to come back to our command line. All right, so now you can go ahead and download the actual GitHub repository, which contains the Python script, which is going to be doing the looping, right? So for that, I'm going to use Git, and Git does come pre-installed on the Raspbian OS or the Raspberry Pi OS. So I'm going to say git clone, and then we need to put in the URL, which is https://github.com/random over to Brit. That's my GitHub name / Raspi Looper, like this. So when I press enter, it should download that entire repository for me. And now if I say ls, I should be able to see that it has created a directory called Raspi Looper. I can cd into that, I can change directory into that, Raspi Looper, like that. And now we can see that there's a bunch of different files here. So first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to run device.py, so or devices.py. I'm going to say sudo python 3 devices.py, and now device, that's a dot.py, dot.py. Okay, so now this script essentially just gives me a list of different audio devices that PyAudio finds and the indexes that PyAudio associates with those. So now the thing that I'm interested in is USB audio device, and we can see that the index is 1, so we need to remember that. Okay, so next I'm going to run settings.py. So I'm going to type in python 3 settings.py, and this is going to ask for a bunch of different parameters regarding the audio that we are using. So for most cheap sound cards, 44.1 kilohertz is the right sample rate. So I'm going to put that in 44100, like that. Now the buffer size. So the buffer size is important because it basically determines how much in sync or out of sync your loops are going to be. On my laptop, I can easily use a buffer size of 128 or even less than that, but the Raspberry Pi is a slower computer and it cannot handle that. The Raspberry Pi 0W really couldn't handle anything less than about 4000, and that's a problem because at a sample rate of 40 kilohertz, that means your loops will be out of sync at most by 1/10 of a second, which is sort of a deal breaker. On the Raspberry Pi 4, I've found that a buffer size of 512 sort of works, but a buffer size of 1024 works better, and at a buffer size of 1024, your loops will be out of sync at most by 1/40 of a second, which to me is acceptable. So I'm going to put in 1024. Now, latency correction in milliseconds, you know, for now, I'm not going to worry about that. I'm going to put in a random value. Input device index 1 and 1. We checked that earlier. And now, enter margin for late button press in milliseconds. So this essentially, you'll probably understand better what exactly this does if you watch the demo video for the looper, but it basically is how late you're allowed to press the button to stop recording on a track. Now I find that a value of about 500 milliseconds works well for this, so I'm going to put that in. Okay, so that's done. So now we need to run python 3 latency.py. So this is actually going to try and measure the latency of the sound card and the Raspberry Pi, you know, the round trip latency. So I'm going to press enter, and it says make sure any hardware monitoring is turned off and hold speaker and microphone close together. So what this means, if you're using the setup that I described earlier, is that the live output on the looper must be disconnected or turned off, and the loop's output must be feeding back into the microphone. All right, so it's going to play a click, and then it's going to listen for the click. It's going to try and calculate the delay between that, and it's going to find out the latency based on that. So I'm going to press enter, and it's found that the latency is 69 milliseconds with a confidence of 9.9 standard deviation. So that's a good result. And I say, yes, set this as the measured value, latency correction value. And I press enter and press enter, and that's done. So now we have done all of that and everything is set up. The thing that's left to do is to set it up so that every time the Raspberry Pi boots up, it goes straight into the looper mode. Now, in order to do that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to edit a file, and I'm not really very well versed on Linux, but I believe that this is just a terminal script that runs each time the Raspberry Pi boots up. So I'm going to say sudo nano /home/pi/.bashrc, like this. Okay, this is just nano is a text editor, and I'm going to edit this file called .bashrc. Now if you go to the bottom of the file, I'm just going to add a couple of lines. So now what I'm going to tell it to do is first cd home by a raspberry looper, like that, and it's going to go into that directory where we have all our Python scripts. And then the next thing is sudo python3 main.py, and this is the main Python script that actually does all the looping. So now that I've added these two lines, I'm going to press Control X to exit. I'm going to say yes to save the changes. I'm going to press enter to save as the same file name. And yeah, so right now if you reboot the Raspberry Pi, it should go straight into the looper mode. But there's one more thing that I want to do, which is I want to edit a configuration file for the audio driver and change one setting, which I'll show you. So sudo nano etc pulse default.pa. So pulse is some kind of audio driver, I think. It's not really a driver because you don't really have drivers on Linux, but it's the closest thing I can relate it to as someone who is primarily a Windows user. So now I can go down. I am looking for, I am looking for this line here, load module suspend on idle. I am going to comment out this line. Okay, so that tells it, you know, if a device, just because a device hasn't been used for a while, don't, you know, forget about it, don't suspend it, because audio is, after all, the primary thing we're using our Raspberry Pi for, and so we want our audio device to always be active. So Control X, Y, enter. All right, so now that's pretty much, you should be done, and you should be able to reboot and start looping. Cheers.